Namaskar, I'm Anjini Kaul from Department of Education in Science and Mathematics, NCERT. Today we are here to discuss about the module Pedagogy of Science under Nishtha. We have with us two more experts. On my left-hand side is Professor Dinesh Kumar, who's head Department of Education in Science and Mathematics, NCERT. Next to Professor Dinesh is Dr. R.R. Koiring. Dr. Koiring is from Department of Curriculum Studies, NCERT, New Delhi. As I said, we are going to discuss about pedagogy of science. Before talking to the experts, let me briefly introduce you to this module. What science is all about? We are discussing about this. How children learn science at upper primary stage? What are the learning outcomes which a student should achieve at upper primary stage? To achieve these learning outcomes, what should be the pedagogical processes? In this particular module, we have given three examples. One is physical properties of metals and nonmetals. Diversity exists in plants. How sound is produced? These are the three examples which are given in detail. Apart from this, we have tried to give various tasks which teachers will do during training program. We have tried to integrate the content, pedagogy, and assessment in the module. Wherever appropriate, we have tried to weave in ICT. We have also given references at the end of the module. These references will supplement this module. If, as a teacher or teacher educator, I would like to know more about continuous and comprehensive evaluation, I can go through the document which NCERT has published. If I want to know more about learning outcomes, a document has been published by NCERT in 2017. How I should assess my children during various tasks, a source book of assessment is also developed by NCERT. So let us discuss about pedagogy of science in detail. So my first question will be to Professor Dinesh Kumar. Professor Dinesh, since we are talking about pedagogy of science, so it becomes very, very important what science is all about, and particularly at upper primary stage, how children learn.
See, when we are looking at science, science is basically to know or to acquire knowledge. So from that perspective, the whole process of learning science is about curiosity. And we all know that human being has always been curious. And children are naturally curious persons. So it is very important that we have to nurture, we have to inculcate the habit of curiosity among children. And in order to satisfy their curiosity, we need to really follow the whole process in such a way that children are able to understand and appreciate the topics and concepts which are there in their curriculum. Yeah. And in the curriculum at upper primary stage especially, I'll not go much detail about the basic concepts of science and what should be there in science. And we all know that it can be termed to be a process, it can be termed to be an inquiry, a way of living also. So I'm not going into that detail. Mm-hmm. But what I'm trying to emphasize here, that when we are talking to children at upper primary stage, mm-hmm. it is very important that their natural curiosity has to be satisfied, mm-hmm. and the processes which are to be there into the classroom process, in that they are able to understand and appreciate the concepts which are there. If you look at the curriculum, in the curriculum we have the concepts like food, material, the living world. Mm-hmm. So these are the examples which are very common, and upper primary children are being exposed to the concepts of science for the first time. Mm-hmm. Before that, they are learning environmental studies and understanding about themselves and also their immediate surroundings in a very joyful and a playway method. Mm-hmm. But the moment it comes to a serious discipline of science, in that again we cannot take children to a very high level of research. We have to engage children in such a way that whatever immediate surrounding experiences are there, based on the themes and concepts which are there in the curriculum, so based on that we have to engage them, we have to explore them. And scientific process is about this only, that observing the phenomena or the things happening, and then understanding the process, and after that having some kind of theory and hypothesis, and then in order to understand or to validate that, we have to really design some experiment or activity, and based on that ultimately we can arrive at a particular conclusion. So for an upper primary children, I consider that the whole process of science should be such that it is going to really satisfy their natural curiosity in a very simple way. For example, one example I would be allowed to cite here, that in the curriculum it is World of Living is there, and when we are talking of World of Living, then it is very important that we need to understand what kind of living diversities are there. So for the purpose of a systematic studies, it is very important that a child should be able to systematically group the organism in such a way that he or she can identify, can understand the similarities and differences, and easy to understand and classify them. So for that purpose, it begins in a very simple and humble way, that in the primary stage children have done about the simple classification of plants like herbs, shrub and trees, and similarly for organism which can either walk on the land, which can swim, which can fly. So these are the basic properties which have been identified. True. But when the children are growing up, then of course more specific criteria are to be defined. One example I will simply quote, that if we are understanding the similarities and differences, then a child will be ultimately able to appreciate that simply by studying the pattern of veins present in the leaf, he or she will be able to group the organism based whether it is a monocotyledon or a dicotyledon. That all will come later on, and I'm citing an example that based on the pattern of that we can identify this. So science has to be a very natural and immediate contextualization, and linking it with the surrounding and experiences for a small children.
True.
I consider science that way.
Yeah. Very beautifully you have talked about that children will be able to identify, differentiate and classify organisms. You are focusing on questioning in the classroom, which is very important. And to seek answer to these questions, you're talking about conduct simple investigations.
Yes.
And very nicely you talked about how to apply concepts to the real life situation. We have to give chance to children to exhibit creativity and exhibit planning, you know, designing, things like that.
Yes.
Let us make our children sensitive towards environment. Let us inculcate values among these children. So these are all learning outcomes which our document is talking about. So to achieve these learning outcomes, Dr. Koring, I would like to ask you, what kind of pedagogy will you suggest? Of course, we have given various examples in our module, but I would like you to elaborate on this.
To begin with, there is no one method or one pedagogy where you can achieve all the learning outcome in science.
That is something very important which you have to focus.
So, but there are researches which has been conducted, and a large body of research on teaching of science inform us that at the primary level, the recommended pedagogy is hands-on and inquiry-based.
Yeah.
So what we do in hands-on way, as Professor Dinesh Kumar was telling, that things should be related to the child experiences, child surrounding.
Yes.
That means when we talk about hands-on way of learning science, basically they have to experience it.
Yeah.
See, by playing with hands or by seeing it, you know, naturally, engaging in activities and like that. So hands-on and inquiry base of teaching of science. Now, coming to the pedagogy which you are talking about in this module, we have listed a number of pedagogical approach where a teacher can't follow. But these are not one-to-one correspondence with the learning outcome which we have given in the learning outcome document.
Yeah, true.
These are a broad, suggestive, pedagogical approach. However, teaching of science, as Professor Dinesh was mentioning about, science is nothing but a systematic way of, you know, inquiring, then searching for connections between different properties or parts. So now to come to this science, inquiring about this science, we necessarily suggest activity-based teaching. Now, by activity-based teaching, we need not mean only doing certain things inside the classroom. So, activity-based could be like performing, of course, one simple experiment to find out the thing which you would like to study, or to have a discussion among the peer groups.
True.
The group activity.
That's
an activity.
The best method of learning, you know, when you interact with peers.
Then to also to go out and observe some natural phenomenon or a plant, wildlife, animal, or a museum, whatever. These are all activity. Now, this apart, we also have an observation. Now, we conducted an activity and we observe, we come to a critical conclusion, what is all about. That's why we always said that activity as a part and parcel of learning science. That means activity should form as a part of learning science. Now, when I say this, through activity, you have to necessarily arrive at concept. Now, if you perform activity and if you arrive concepts or theories through activity, you are trying to make some meaning out of that. Now, what is happening in today's classroom is that in the name of activity, many of us or many teachers which we have seen or which is happening in the classroom, they just perform for the sake of doing activity, without trying to
understand,
really involve students, provoke them and what to arrive at. So this is not the activity which we are advocating in this module. The activity which we are advocating here is how students can learn meaningful concept or theories
and
or
in
laws
a meaningful way.
In a meaningful way. That's why we call it constructivism.
Approach,
they have how they can construct knowledge actually, and that will be a meaningful to them. So if you look at the science learning which is taking place, or for that matter, the evaluation process which is happening in today's classroom, you know, what is asked in the exam is being learned. Rote memorization, which is dominating in today's classroom, because what is asked in the exam is being memorized. And you go and give it in the exam by memorizing it. So this is not going to help, you know, the objective of teaching science, which we have been mentioning about creativity, to inculcate creativity, you know, scientific temper, you know, critical thinking. Now, what we need to do is that we need to move away from this rote learning. Now, to do this, we have to change examination pattern, which is happening, by asking higher order thinking, like application-based type of teaching, and also to change the way we are teaching science. Because why student has to memorize? There are two way or three ways maybe. One is because they have to give exam. That's why they are asked. Or number two could be because it is so boring on the way the pedagogical process we are following inside the classroom, because we may not be giving opportunity for them to explore, or for that matter, to interact or to make mistake also. So these are essential part.
So children learn, you know.
Of course.
I would supplement one more thing. What Torin is saying is very important. It's not that only for the purpose of examination children should be taught science. It is also about the competency building. It is the competence that is more important. And for that purpose, whatever activities or demonstrations or peer interactions, whatever we can think of, ultimately that should lead to the development of the competency. And one more thing. There are many examples given. One example example I would cite that when we talk about in the living diversity, study of cells. Mm-hmm. So the onion peel is the best example which is given. Mm-hmm. But take my words that if children are exposed to different kinds of plants and organisms to study under a microscope, they will arrive at the same conclusion that all organisms are made up of cells. So only thing that has to be done.
So this is what we have discussed about pedagogy of science. But then one thing is very important here, that when we are talking about teaching learning process in the classroom, we have to take care for the children with special needs, and we have to give them equal opportunity the way we are giving to other children. That has been very nicely weaved in this module. And let us give chance to children to be creative, you know. You know, when they write short stories or poems or things like that, you know, it helps them to develop the creative mind.
Yeah.
So one such riddle has been given in this particular module. I would like to read it quickly. I am 1600 year old. My hometown is in Delhi. My guardian is Chandragupta. I'm 7 meters tall and my weight is 6.5 tons. My body is made up of metal. I'm still standing erect and I'm not turned into a pile of rust. Who am I? Here a child is connecting his previous knowledge with the present knowledge. As Dr. Koering said, that children learn, you know, gradually they construct their own knowledge. And in the module, we have also talked about the various tasks, as I said earlier, that teachers will take during training program.
Can I add something here, Dr. Anjali?
Yeah, definitely.
This riddle is very, really interesting. And I would suggest teacher or student, even involving student, they can think of many such activities and things so that it becomes interesting as well as in the local context that will be there.
Yeah, definitely.
So we can think of
more such things. So, so if I conclude here, because what we have talked about so far is that we have to know our student first. We have to develop a rapport with the student, then encourage children to pose questions. And to seek answer to these questions, we really have to go through certain pedagogical processes. We have to see that whether our students have achieved those learning outcomes. If they have achieved, fine. If they have not achieved, then teacher either she has to think about some another pedagogical process, or maybe given some additional inputs if she thinks that there's nothing wrong with her pedagogical process. So thank you very much, Professor Dinesh and Dr. Koering, and thank you.
Thank you.